Hi everyone, this is the 24th of March 2020. Rohit Srivastava here, getting you through what the markets are doing and what are the key factors to watch out for over the next week. So let's do that with a lot of charts today. And before I come to this chart, which I use every day in my daily update, which is essentially to update subscribers on my ongoing wave count, what I want to highlight is something that I mentioned in the podcasts, and I think has been very, very true over the last couple of days. If you're really just watching, and I, in fact, on Twitter, I noted that the first thing I would want to go away is the overnight 24/7 futures market, because it creates a lot of confusion, not just in the view, but also for everybody who's trading. For example, in India, you wouldn't have access to SGX futures. So why the heck do you really need SGX futures? So it's only to indicate to other people, or maybe FIAs or someone has access. But, you know, more than a decade ago, when you were not even trading or watching Dow futures closely every day, all you were looking at is the overnight close in the Dow or the Nasdaq. Now people are watching the futures in the day. You take a trade on that, and the real trend may be something else. So you really need to pay attention to the overall trend. The daytime swings might mean nothing to what the underlying trend is. And if you're just looking at the daytime trend to think, oh, well, this is up so much or down so much, which has now become the normal daily volatility, which is 4-5% on any index, then you'll probably end up being on the wrong side. So we're going to try and look at the overall picture. There are a couple of, you know, counts that fit the Nifty. So people are asking, is the worst over? Has it bottomed? And every time it bounces, that's what it looks like. So when you got this first bounce after it hit the lower circuit on two Fridays ago, then it actually looked like that, because you were completing something that would have counted well as a five wave decline. But from there on, you actually extend it. So there's this thing with five waves that, you know, if you actually have five waves, if you want to extend it, what do? You actually end up adding four more waves, which is, and the reason that ends up happening is that what you get in a 5+4 environment is nine waves, which means that the third wave is extended. And because the third wave itself shows 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what you're counting is 1, 2, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then the fourth and the fifth. So you have two waves in the beginning, 1 and 2, and then you have two waves at the end, which is 4 and 5. So when you add it up to the five waves in the third, you essentially end up getting 9. So an extension, which is when this low broke, meant that you add four more waves, which means 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so this is the fourth, where again it is possible for you to count 5. And then if that doesn't happen, if you bounce up a bit and start extending lower, which is what we are watching out for today morning, if you do continue to extend below the recent lows we made yesterday or today's low, then you would add another 4 waves to it, and it would become 13 waves. So it would become 5, and then, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 more down. So it would be 1 of 5, 2 of 5, 3 of 5, 4 of 5, and 5 of 5 before you really complete. So that's something we have to navigate on a real-time basis. In other words, should I mark this as 1 of 5, or should I mark this as wave A complete, is something we'll only know probably by the end of the day or tomorrow, based on the movements that it does so far. But at this point, can you say it is complete? You'd really want to use some tool. You could use a trend line break, you could use a moving average, which is right now running at around 8,500 and falling, or you could simply use a retracement. Some people would like that the 61% retracement of the last leg at least be surpassed before you change your stance, which would also come to around 8,380-390. So you have these resistance levels. Last week on Friday, I noted that around 9,000 till not crossed, which was near this average over here, and also a retracement of the previous fall, then probably we would head lower all over again. And that's what ended up happening. In fact, I didn't expect it would gap down on Monday itself, but that's what it did. And so similarly, the same thesis continues, because that's what has been working throughout this fall. You're actually having to look at hourly charts rather than daily charts, simply because of the speed of what is going on. So if you do extend on the downside, then everybody knows 2016, we had a bottom from where this rally started at 6825, which is somewhere down here. And if this does extend, there's no reason why it can't really retest the 6825 low. Now, another immediate level would be the trend line of the last two lows, which itself comes in at around 7273. Now, with that, you'd start thinking about, yeah, all this is fine, but why shouldn't the market bottom out now that the Fed is doing whatever it takes? So that takes us to what you really need to watch And I write about these factors almost every day, all the macro factors that I discuss in my daily notes. And then I explain them in a lot of detail in the long short report. So if you haven't read that, one of the things people want to know is, because this fall is so steep, when was the last time you had a steep fall? You can refer to places like 1987. But the best or closest example probably goes to, you know, all the way back to the previous super cycle bear market, which is in the US, was in 1928. What you're looking at is an almost 100-year chart in the Dow, and because we're looking at such a long time horizon, and mostly I like to use logarithmic charts increasingly. So what we're going to do is we're going to zoom into 1929, which is down here, and then we're going to look at what really happened in this first leg, because this is the closest mimic. Now, of course, we know history repeats, you know, doesn't repeat exactly, but it rhymes is a truth. Because when you actually compare various time periods, they never are exactly the same. But the ferocity of some of the super cyclical degree bear markets in the initial stages is of course there. For example, wave A of any bear market sometimes can be very, very large, which is what ended up happening here. And so this first wave, this first decline, which I would actually mark as one of this fall. So my wave count here is actually 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. The first wave itself was almost a 20% dip in the Dow. But what's more interesting is that the third wave, which is from here all the way to here, is almost a 50 to 60% decline. So that is pretty significant. And that's what we don't usually expect, the kind of extension that we saw here. So it kept on going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So I had to complete 9 waves down here to really complete this 5-wave decline. And so when we're actually looking at the current phase, and I published these charts in the March 3rd long short report showing that the Dow at that time had done 20% at this point. And so if it did start a third wave, it would end up being, if it's going to be similar, it's going to be similarly large. So far, the extension is pretty much. Now, the debate that we're having as analysts is the third wave really complete? Have we done 3 and 4 here? Because fourth is just a 23% retracement, which is completely normal. It's possible you can mark this as fourth, but what EWI is preferring to do at this stage is like in 1929, because of that extended fall. And if that is the case, and there I mentioned this last time, couple of sentiment indicators that I track that are still not reached medium term lows, I've published them. I'll not talk about them here, but basically what they tell us is that you haven't reached a panic bottom. People have not really panicked yet as far as the trading in options is concerned. So I look at a thing like the volume put call ratio. Fine, let me refer to it. And so this chart which you're seeing really has a lot of data, because I've been keeping it for as long as the data became available. If you can't calculate yourself, I get it from the derivatives info kit that Sher Khan's been publishing ever since derivatives started. You get the volume put call ratio of the market. And I take an average of that. And so every time you have a bearish trend, you actually see the volume PCR go up a lot, typically goes to the 0.6 or 0.7 level, even in terms of an average reading. And what has been interesting is that in August, when we actually bottomed, when you sold off into those lows, the mid caps were crashing, the volume PCR had reached this red line over here, which is close to the 0.7 reading on a 40-day average. And where is it now? Just last week, I've not updated this, but it's not very far off from here. It's barely even crossed this first red line, which means the readings have really not been coming up to 0.5, 0.6. Now we're going to expire in a few days. And it shows that people, despite such a sharp fall, are not really hedging themselves or panicking. Of course, you had FIIs hedging. In fact, at the start of the month itself, FIIs had the longest long position, the largest short position. And a couple of days after that, the client side also had the longest, the largest long position. So you had extremes in data, which typically in the past we have seen closer to market highs or lows within a couple of days. But that's not what ended up happening. You got a small bounce and then it sold off post wholly into even lower lows and has been falling ever since. So those readings have not helped. In fact, what you're actually seeing in the data is that FI is now here, which you can see on the right hand side. From that peak position of almost 173,000 contracts on the 6th of March, are down to only 40,000 contracts, which means as the market has been falling, they've actually covered most of their shorts. And similarly, large players who are probably significantly long at 110,000 contracts have reduced it to 30,000 contracts. So as we've hit these lows, into yesterday. This is yesterday's end of day data. The long and short positions of both sides actually cut significantly. Now, while this may appear like a positive divergence against the market, what I have not seen is this significant a divergence. We've seen divergences between subsequent higher highs or lower lows, but within the same sell-off to see the position actually reduce and the market not having bounced is something we've really not seen. So it shows that actually even the FIs are not, they were extremely hedged at the start of the month, but at the end of the month, they actually unhedged. And so that's what is showing up in the volume PCR readings, which is very unusual because, like I said, on all previous occasions, you've seen very high readings. And it would tell you that, medium term panic bottom has not yet occurred. And when that happens, maybe this number shoots up again, if not to the same highs, to a lower high. And in that sense, develops an actual positive divergence. So that is just a thought I'm having. But like I said, the data at this point doesn't really support the idea that a final low point has really been reached for the Nifty. And similarly, even in the Dow, the EWI publishes something known as the TRIN. I won't put that chart here, but it has not really reached the extremes that we usually see when you reached a medium term low. So they're really thinking this is 1, 2, and 3, which is even more bearish. But if I simply just take the third wave, a 60% or 50% drop from where we are, this high was 27,000, then we are talking of going down to around 13,000. So that's the size of move. But a more appropriate level might actually be this level that you see here, the previous swing low, the fourth wave low, which is closer to around 15,500. So that's where I think possibly the first point where market stop, which is the fourth wave of lower degree, is where the sell-off could stop. If it is still not over, till you really get a confirmation that it's over, it's not over. Don't look at the day-to-day 4 to 5% moves, but try to look at the bigger picture. But then you'll come back to with the same question, but what about the Fed? So they cut rates here again, and now they are saying we'll do whatever it takes in terms of buying the bonds in the market, because what this sell-off has done is pushed junk bond yields up. It has caused the spreads between the high yield credit and the treasury bond yields, say the 10-year, to a record high or almost to a multi-year high, which shows that junk bonds or lower rated bonds are at extreme risk of either going into default, and in this environment, which is driven more by coronavirus, they'd want to actually not let that happen if it's only an event that is causing it rather than an actual failure. Though for a long time, it would be just that low rates that have allowed them to continue to borrow and keep many of those bonds afloat and continue to pay them through fresh borrowings, which is what has been happening on the background. We know that the debt levels in the corporate bond as a percentage of GDP are already at the highest. So here's a chart which gives you a perspective from way back 1969 to 1990, and what you can actually see is the percentage corporate US debt to GDP ratio, and this has peaked with each of these cycles from 1990, the recession there, then of course the tech bubble, the 2008, and of course this is where we are now. So this is why the risk gets escalated, and there are two factors to watch. See, we all know that the Fed is intervening. The question is it going to work, not going to work? And the way to actually look at it is that this time around, it's not just the Fed that is stepping in. It's actually everyone else that is really coming in. And that means that usually when this kind of action would be taken, you'd get the dollar falling. And that's what you would have expected last night, but you actually got only a small drop. So you want to watch the dollar for the next couple of days. And here's the chart of the dollar that I've just published this morning on the site, which is that you had wave one, you had wave two, you had a third, and fourth was going on. I was looking for the fifth to generate. I think I shared that chart yesterday on social media. And even after the event that has happened, so far we are still within this range. So it looks like a triangular fourth. And what I'm anticipating is a fifth wave to 107. Now you watch for the next couple of days whether that's happening, and it's a sign whether these actions have worked, because initially the dollar was falling when the markets were under pressure, and that's what drove gold prices up into late February. But eventually it just turned around. Moment the US started taking action on rates, the dollar bottomed, discounting that, and turned completely around. And the reason it did that is that it also started to anticipate that next in line, it's not just the US, but everyone else is going to step in. And that's what you've seen over the last week. You've seen Britain, Europe, Japan to some extent. You'd probably see more from Japan. All of them stepping in. I think the odd guy out really is India. We haven't done anything on rates. We've done, but then we have done something. We've done additional bond buying. I think 1 lakh crores is what the OMOs that were announced by, or rather LTROs as they're calling it, were announced by the RBI in the policy meet. And even after that, they've announced additional bond buying. So they're also doing bond buying. Everybody's doing bond buying, and it's going to various levels from each country. And when you add it all together, the amount of currency buying that probably everyone else is doing is far outweighing what the US may be doing in terms of, you know, in percentage of GDP and so on. So really what you need to watch out for is the effect that it is having on the currency, because after all, that's also stimulation. If you're not really lowering rates to weaken your currency, when you're doing OMOs and you're, you know, pushing currency INR into the system, then you're also indirectly weakening your currency. And that's showing up in the dollar getting stronger against now all pairs rather than only emerging markets, which was the case in Jan and Feb. So I have put out the chart of a couple of currency pairs this morning. The USD JPY, for example, made a double bottom near 101, okay, where it had hit in 2016, and then now again in 2020, it's come there. So if I really zoom in, what you're looking at is a triangular pattern. I thought the lower end will hold, and it actually did, even though it spiked below it. It never broke it. It came back and closed inside. And now we are at the verge of breaking the upside, which is at around 111. So once that happens, you're in a larger third wave for the USD JPY, which actually has a move all the way to 168. Of course, not in a day or a week. It's going to take several months for that to happen. But my sense is that this would be a move to a much weaker currency. Very, very similar thing you can see in the pound. You can see it in the euro. And so what you're really getting is, I think, round two of what we were calling a currency war between 2017 and 18, rather 16 and 17, when the dollar index made its first powerful rally. And that was also on the back of whatever it takes policy by Europe and then Japan, Abenomics, which was essentially about weakening the currency. And we've seen a long pause in that. The DXY has consolidated all this while. For some while, even it looked bearish. But now what you're looking at in these charts is that most of these currencies are now starting to weaken against the dollar as they're taking policy action to, you know, somehow kickstart their economies. Whether that works or not is something that only time will tell. But at the time that this action is taking place, what usually happens is what happened in 2016, which is that it drove down commodity prices. It hit most of the emerging markets that were commodity producers, and it somewhat slowed down the economies. And so it also ends up hitting India, even though lower commodity prices are good for India. We end up taking a hit simply because, you know, the world economy ends up slowing down in the process when you have a rising dollar. So the rising dollar is the central focus, I think, for me. And the long term trend, I think, has changed from being down to up for the time being. Looking at all of the individual pairs, the signs are even larger. But what you need to think about is what is the secondary rub-off effect of this. So right in the beginning, I spoke about, you know, junk bonds and bond spreads and so on. What has happened since the dollar started to rally? And so I put out a couple of charts, I think, of the Spanish bond yields and so on. And people wonder, why do I write all these charts? Who's trading those markets anyway? And my answer is that I can't help that people have not educated themselves about understanding macro market behavior. And why it's important to study various moving parts. But I'll continue to do that and hope that you educate yourself either from what I'm writing and, you know, speaking about, or from, you know, other readings that you can do online. The reason is that we are in a global market. We have to see how markets react to different forces. And right now, the direct impact of weakening currencies in many markets is that players not only pull off on equity investing, but also on bonds. So if you have, you know, if you're seeing the euro or the pound fall significantly, you probably don't want to be invested in European equities, but then you also don't want to be invested in European bonds. And the same would be true with emerging market bonds, where the risk will be even higher. And so what you saw is a big jump up in bond yields immediately as the US 10-year bond yield also, you know, bottomed out. It had fallen in panic all the way to below 1%, 0.5%, or 0.4%, or maybe even 0.25% in the 10-year and 30-year. And then immediately they reversed from there. The yields mean reverted very fast, you know, back above 1%. And when that happened, many of the bond markets actually broke out. So what you're seeing here on this chart, this is the Spanish bond yield chart. It's something that I published a couple of years ago as well. And I'd shown that this was a triangle here, and this was the last decline in yields, which is the last rally in the Spanish bond yields. And then they bounced back and remained flat for a while. But what has happened now very recently is this jump up in yields. And this has happened in many markets. At the bottom, you can see this is the German 10-year. I move here, you can see the Russian 10-year. This is spiked. And so what I'm watching very, very closely is whether the same happens here as well. The Indian currency, better late than never, has started to weaken, just like most of the other currency pairs, catching up with what the dollar is doing. But of course, on a relative basis, we are still far stronger on the currency than many other places, which means we are overvalued. And I sense that at some point we do a catch up. And the thing to watch is whether bond yields also go up. So this is where RBI is intervening. They're trying to keep this from not happening. I have marked this as 1, 2, 3, 4, which would be a sign that bond yields in India continue to decline and don't go up, which is what we all want. But if that fails to happen, so I'm watching this swing low, which is the wave one low, which you should not overlap with, which is close to around 6.495%. So let me say it's 6.5. If you do see the 10-year go above 6.5%, I would sense that this move did not complete a 5 waves and was corrective, and in that sense would change the trend strongly from lower to higher bond yields, just like we've seen in many of the other bond markets. So this is why it's important to watch all of that. The first impact of weakening currencies is that people start pulling out of not just equity but bond markets, and bond yields start to spike, especially the riskier bond markets. And that's where all the intervention is happening, including in our own market. And if the intervention proves short of what we need, because you already got 50,000 crores worth of outflows from Indian bonds along with equity, if that outflow continues, it will continue to put upward pressure on these yields. And that's what I'll be watching out for. If it crosses 6.5%, means you're headed much higher, and that means going all the way back to, who knows, 7% and then even 8% over a 1 year period is what I will start anticipating, even if it doesn't happen right away. But that would essentially change the reading for the time being till new evidence shows up that you don't have a lower top, lower bottom. Now, if you want a final, the lower top, lower bottom to break, you want prices to go above the wave too high, which is at around 6.692. So that's, let's say, 6.7%. So 6.5 would be the overlap. 6.7% would be where this fall is definitely 3 waves and you can't count it with any other alternate possible. And that would then change the entire structure from a decline to a larger upward trend on the other direction. So that's what all the intervention is directed towards, I think, is keeping the bond markets from going into a panic. Definitely, when US says that we are going to buy any amounts required, then that's the highest level of easing to the market. And the answer is then, have we completed wave A, or are we still going to see some more panic? So we continue to watch the currency and bond markets for that signal, because sometimes you can get a short term bump up, or even before the effects of those positive news items play out, there's some hidden selling, margin selling, somebody's payoff, something that we don't know, some redemptions happening somewhere that can still create another round of selling. And if you see that, you'll see it in all of those markets that I discussed. You'll see, if not yields jump, you'll see the currency weaken. And if you continue to see that, if you see the DXY heading towards 107, which is what I've been writing, then it would be a sign that there's still pressure in the short term, and any bounce up would actually tend to fail. So we'll probably look at these reversal levels. If you really need a very tight one, I'll be watching maybe the 20 hour average. You can choose your own, you can choose different averages that you want. That will be closer to 8200 as a very tight level to watch. Broadly, you can watch 8500 if you want to wait for all the way to watch. This high would be at 8883. But once you start trading above 8200, that would be a first sign maybe something's changed. And if you trade above 8500, it would be another sign. Of course, you can say that this is an ending pattern. If you break out above the upper line, so the upper line is at around close to 8500, and above that, the signs that, yeah, we've started something which could be a B wave of larger degree. But what I'll still not rule out, because everybody expects a quick V-shaped recovery, is that if the dollar is still a problem, say you do break out, but you still continue to form some kind of a basing formation as pressure remains on, you know, various assets, so you stop making new lows, but you still have specific stocks selling off and keeping pressure on the indices is something that can also happen. So don't rule that out, because we always expect that, you know, you'll get an immediate and complete reversal because the sell-off has been so sharp, which is typical. So typically that is what you get. In fact, since we were making comparisons with, you know, global bubble tops, the other one that I should speak of before signing off is Japan itself. So Japan's super cycle degree top, 1989-90, almost late 89, early 90, December. And you can see how speedily the fall was, but it's the difference with 1929 and the Japanese sell-off is that this A, B and C, the C is almost equal to wave A in the case of 1929, C was much larger and the entire bear market was consumed in wave C. In this case, it was ABC, then you got an X wave, then you got another decline. So you had these pauses, but note that these pauses were actually not significant. So when I look at US, I end up anticipating you get a B wave, which can retrace up to 50%. You saw it even in the second quarter of 1929, in the last quarter. But then when you got the next X wave, it only did around 38%. So it didn't end up being that significant. So each market period have their variations. But the first sell-off here too was very, very steep. It was relentless. It went all the way back to the 1988 low before it halted, similar to what I showed around 16,500 for the Dow. There's a similar level where it went back to the previous swing before it even made a wave B pullback. You just had this breakdown, wave one, wave two, and then the third was significantly extended before you had the fifth. Or rather, in this case, it might actually look like you did subdivide into four, which is what the alternate is, that, you know, the Dow has done 23% retracement and the fourth wave is actually over. And then this entire structure is actually a fifth. So while I might mark five here, because this looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's actually down here. This may be an ending pattern. Right at the fag end of this move. And so even here it would have looked like it's the fifth ending here, but actually the fifth also was large enough, which is what I'm also waiting to see, because if the first and third waves have been so big, can the fifth really be truncated? And all the actions that have been taken so far, the interventions are creating hope that you can truncate, but maybe there is some overhang left before those actions start working on the market. And that is why we should watch for a reversal rather than simply go by the news. So even in India's case, the fall has been pretty steep. You've given back almost all the gains from 2016. And the main previous swing, this is the demonetization low. We are below that. And now we are probably the main next support is at 6825, which is the 2016 low. And that's the one that we're going to be watching in terms of where, you know, things can, at least this round of selling can complete. So to conclude, we are in a super cycle degree bear market as far as India is concerned. So if that's the answer you're looking for, then that's what I think is happening. And one of the sub effects of that is a contraction in credit, which is what you're seeing since 2010, which is where the economic winter in economic sense probably starts. You know, you see this complete contraction. People didn't want to borrow anymore into 2015. You had these small bump ups, but it's not really taking off. And so unless that really happens, you don't have change. And that's the first sign that it has a deflationary effect. The counteractive action is usually to try and inflate either through cutting rates or spending, a bit of both, which we've been trying to do, which is why markets continue to stay higher for longer. But everything has its tipping point. And now we are, you know, facing the risk as to a significant slowdown happening because of, you know, very macro factors, not just our own, but global. And how do we really get this thing to change? And when that happens, we probably get longer term cycles reverse. But you continue to watch this for the super cycle degree economic cycle. But of course, markets are going to be ahead. Just as they were on the upside, they can deviate from economic fundamentals. Even when the final bottom occurs, equities can bottom way ahead of the economic cycle itself. So we study this to know where we are in the cycle, but the timing of the market has to be done by looking at the individual markets themselves. So that's all in this update from me. Thank you.